welcome. We're so thankful that you're here with us today. Listen to this cool scripture. It says that when Peter was up the mountain with Jesus and John and James, he said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it's good for us to be here." It is good for us to be here today. I pray that today would be a great worship service. Thanks for joining us.
And so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order, and who makes the open a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Take my place, that you would bear my cross. Oh, you laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. We'll be right back.
good morning. Welcome to Highlands Online. I'm Colleen, and I want to thank you for joining us today. Just a few reminders for upcoming things we have going on. We have our all-church congregational meeting. It's today on Zoom at 7 p.m., so you can go to our Connect tab on the website and get everything you need for that. And upcoming also, we have Highlands 101 next weekend. If you want to learn how to get connected within the church, find out about small groups, and just figuring out how you can serve within our community, go ahead and join us for Highlands 101, and we will have an online version coming up as well. Next up, we have our men's retreat. It will be coming up this next weekend, so go ahead and check out this video.
Hey guys, it's Ben. I just wanted to connect with you real quick about this upcoming men's retreat on March 5th. It's one overnight. It's $40. Some of you guys will be able to go with us Friday morning at 10 and get out there and kind of get set up, and the rest of you can join us after you get off of work. That's real easy. We'll sort that out. But what I wanted to tell you is that this is a retreat center, a campground that you've probably never been to. It's squashed between the hills of Lake Nacimiento and Lake San Antonio, and it's a really, really cool place. They've got a full, huge kitchen, and we're gonna eat good, I'll tell you that much. They've got horseshoes, they've got a zip line, they've got a pool, they've got a place to play like Ultimate Frisbee. Anyway, it's a really cool place. There's hiking trails, and there's gonna be a lot of opportunity for you to connect with God, connect with other men, friends of yours, and even have some time alone if you need it. If you're a guy right now, I know that some of you, with all this COVID stuff, are either the busiest you've ever been in your life, or the opposite. And both y'all are struggling. I know that. I'm talking to you. I know what's going on. You need this retreat, and I want to see you there. It's going to be a great time. So if you want to sign up, follow the link below. It's on Eventbrite. It's real simple, real easy. There's more details there. And if you've got any other questions, you can send me an email at ben@highlandsadventure.org, and I'd love to connect with you. All right, thanks.
Okay, also upcoming, we have Family Movie at Park Cinemas. They're going to have Mickey Mouse Clubhouse on March 13th at 10 a.m. You can go ahead and go to Eventbrite, the link's below, and get all the information for a family fun morning. And our next Highland event that we have coming up is Easter. I know we're all excited about the spring coming. And on April 4th at 9 a.m. and 11 a.m., we're going to have Easter service out here on the lawn again. And you can go ahead and grab a yard sign so that you can make sure that as people are driving by, they're able to find out about Highlands and our service. As always, thanks for your generosity and all that you do for Highlands. And now we're going to continue in worship.
How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished. The end is written, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine? Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could find such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, and I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Savior, I'm yours forever, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. Salvation is
the promise, your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me.
Thank you.
Then came the morning, with still the promise, your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Oh, Jesus, yours is the Christ, my living hope. Oh, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh, God, you are my living hope.
Welcome. We're so thankful that you're here with us today as we continue this conversation called Take Heart, where we're asking, how can we be more cognizant of the constant presence and power of Jesus in our life so that we can actually become courageous and even encouragers of other people rather than discouraged and fearful about the situations that we're in? Today's conversation builds off of last week's conversation, where we were really talking about what it means to truly connect with God. This week, we're going to talk about constant activity and how we can be healed and transformed in that journey of life that seems like it swallows us up. Because we know that it's easy to be enslaved by constant activity. I don't know if you've ever had that experience where you thought, hey, you know what? If only I was more active in my life, if only I had more things to do, if only I had more social functions and more opportunities to connect with other people, then and only then would I truly be fulfilled. And so many people find that what they really experience is a kind of enslavement to their calendar and an enslavement to even the need for constant activity. This feeling, even when you're alone, like there's got to be something going on. There's got to be more happening in my life. Why am I not doing something? My question for you today is one I want you to really think about. Do you ever find yourself becoming dizzy from constant activity? Do you ever find that even though you're not doing something, you sit down and your mind is still running 100 miles an hour? Or do you find that you're honestly just doing so many things all the time that you really never have a sense of grounding in your life? Now, the conversation we're having, as I said before, is building off of last week's conversation, where we really looked into the life of Moses, where he met God at the top of the mountain, and God met him there, and God told Moses God's name and said, I am who I am, I am has sent you. And in that moment, we learned the importance of what it means to change our posture and take off our shoes so that we can, again, be more connected, more cognizant of Jesus's, God's presence and power in our lives so we can be more filled with courage. Now, this week, we are going to flash forward in the story of human history from the moment where Moses was met on the mountain all the way to where Jesus was calling the disciples on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. And Jesus called so many fishermen and different kinds of people like tax collectors, and they followed him. They literally followed him. And when he said, follow me to those people, they would actually step in the same footsteps and footprints that Jesus would have. They would do the things that Jesus did. They would learn to talk like Jesus and minister like Jesus. In fact, some people say that the church that we have today is really stuff that was physically, tangibly extended and translated and shared to us from the people who followed, the people who followed, the people who followed, the people who followed Jesus all the way back. That there is actually not just the Bible that we learn from, but also through tradition that people have communicated more than just the words of Scripture, but actually the actions of Jesus Christ here and today. And so one of the times when Jesus was telling his followers to follow him was when he led them up a mountain. He said, come on, you're going to go with me on essentially an overnight retreat, on a time away experience. And this is what the Scripture says. It says 6 days later, now before that there was teachings and constant activity in the disciples' lives. It was madness. But then it says 6 days later, Jesus took Peter, James, and John, just the three of those, and brought them to the top of a very high mountain where they were alone. That's so important. And it goes on to say, he was transformed in front of them, and his clothes were amazingly bright, brighter than if they had been bleached white. Now, the first thing that we need to learn in order to escape from the confinement or enslavement of constant activity in our life is, number one, spend time with Jesus. This helps you to see his glory. You know, Jesus invites all of us up a mountain. He invites all of us to spend time with him where we can get away. And a lot of times we intuitively hear the words of Jesus. We think about who Jesus is. We do prayerfully spend time with Jesus. But when we focus on Jesus, when anybody focuses on Jesus and really tries to open their heart and mind to the presence of Jesus, they go from that place of not just the earthly knowledge of Jesus, but to the spiritual, heavenly, glory kind of knowledge of Jesus, the one that causes you to recognize that the Jesus that you're following is not just a teacher and not just a rabbi and not just the person that has been calling out to you in an earthly way. This is God of the universe. This is Jesus, the heavenly being, the one who is so much bigger and brighter and more wonderful than we ever really allow ourselves to venture into. You hear people say, oh yeah, I follow Jesus. But when they say it, you can tell the ones that spend time away with Jesus. So that's the first thing that we learn from our scripture today, and that Jesus was teaching his disciples. And we go on to read in Mark 9:4 these words. Elijah and Moses, wait a second, Moses had long gone. He was dead. So was Elijah. These two people, it says, appeared and were talking with Jesus. They were actually in a conversation with Jesus at the top of the mountain. Now, important, before we move on, I want to point out that Elijah represents the second half of the Old Testament, and Moses represents the first half of the Old Testament. Essentially, Jesus was having a dialogue, not just with Scripture, but with the authors of Scripture. Moses is credited for writing or recording the first 5 books of the Bible. So this is essentially Jesus in dialogue, having conversations, not just with dead words, but with living, vibrant words. Goes on to say that when this happened, Peter reacted. Now, I don't know about you, but I've been in awkward situations and I found myself reacting in awkward ways. This is Peter's awkward moment. And I love that this is recorded in Scripture. And one of the cool things that I want to point out to you about the Gospel of Mark, you'll see that this scripture is coming from the book of Mark or the Gospel of Mark in the Bible. Actually, Mark, by church historians, Mark is credited to Peter, who had actually spoken the words. Mark is the one who wrote it down. So this actual testimony is one that some church, early church historians claim was actually Peter's testimony. So I love that Peter was so honest and vulnerable about who he was and the experiences that he had had and the mess ups he had experienced in his life. How many times do we feel like we just kind of would like people to know the shiny, beautiful part of our life and the faithful part of our life? But what a testament and witness that Peter was just really, really honest. He wanted to tell the whole story. And it goes on to say that Peter reacted to all of this by saying to Jesus, Rabbi, teacher, it's good that we're here. I love that Peter's in such a joyous moment. He's turning around and saying, man, this is such a good experience. This is such an awesome moment. We need to memorialize it, is what Peter says. He says, let's make 3 shrines, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. And then even the narrator or the writer of Mark says this. It says, Peter said this because he didn't know how to respond. He was just trying to respond, and it wasn't the right way, it wasn't the wrong way, but he didn't know what to do in that moment when he was encountering the truth of who Jesus was and how big he was and how wonderful he was. And it says, for the three of them were terrified. They were filled with fear when they were watching this. Of course, Jesus is over there just having a nice little coffee chat with Elijah and Moses, and the other three are hiding in the bushes. This is the second thing that you need to know in order to escape from the constant flurry of activity that is going to suck the color out of your life. The second thing is this: take time to read the living gospel, the gospel that is alive. Why? Because you're part of it, because you are actually part of that story. Now, a lot of people look at scripture, and even at the time of Jesus, they looked at the words that were written in some cases over 1,000 years before they had done their ministry and lived their lives. And they thought, you know, those are old, dead, non-applicable words. They don't really relate to me in my life. But actually, Jesus was showing that the gospel is something that is actually vibrant and alive and can be interacted with. And you may think that interacting with a gospel or seeing, let's say, Jesus talking with Elijah and Moses seems like something that has only happened once in human history. And yes, in this case, it did. But the other part of it is, for anybody who is reading the living gospel, who is allowing themselves to enter into the story of what God is doing and to really be swept away by the beautiful truths that are happening, anyone who experiences that, they're in that same space as Peter, John, and James, where they're sitting there watching Jesus in dialogue with Moses and Elijah. Every single morning, faithful Christians wake up, they read the living scripture, and they are in dialogue. They are seeing a dialogue between Jesus and Elijah and a Moses. And they know that it's not just a story that has happened, but it's a story that is happening and that they are a part of it. So if you want to escape this prison called constant activity that is sucking the color out of your life, these are the things that we should do. Spend time away with Jesus and read, reflect on, absorb, internalize the living gospel and allow ourselves to be pulled into that conversation. This is how the story continues. It says in Mark 9, verse 7, then a cloud overshadowed them and a voice spoke from the cloud. This is my son, whom I dearly love. Listen to him. One of my favorite things about that scripture, to go back a little bit, is as I love God saying, this is my son. I have a son, and it's so fun for me to look him in the eyes and say, you are my son. There's no more proud moment. There's no more wonderful moment. I love when people come and they meet my son Luke or my daughter, and I get to say, this is my daughter. This is my son. As a parent, that's such a wonderful experience, because you can see people who know you, and they think they know you, and then they meet your kids, and then they realize, you can see like their eyes are open, they're like, oh, now I really know you. That's what's happening here. God is saying, by the way, this is my son, and if you really want to know me, you're going to get to know my son. You are really going to understand him. And I love that we focus in on these words, listen to him. Listen to him. This is a command from God that we should hear the voice of Jesus in our life, that we should listen to his words. Then it says in Mark 8, chapter 9, verse 8, suddenly, looking around, they no longer saw anyone with them except for Jesus. The third thing that you need to know, in order to escape from the prison of constant activity that sucks away the color of our life, is this: listen, listen to the voice of Jesus. Take it to heart with action. How amazing to think about Peter, who actually heard those words from God spoken over Jesus, listen to him. And then Peter actually put that into practice in his own life. He actually lived out the commands of Jesus. When Jesus said, feed my sheep, Peter went and actually took care of the church. He actually built a system by which people could communicate with one another. He supported missionaries from Jerusalem. They would come into Jerusalem and Peter would raise the funds and try to support the people that were sent out. He would take care of the widows, the orphans, and the poor and the sick. The church was like our church today. It was this living a testimony of obedience to Jesus' commands that we would do what Jesus says, that we would live the way that Jesus would live. And so my encouragement to you is that you wouldn't just find yourself up a mountain. You wouldn't find yourselves on those away places with Jesus, but that you would also find yourself digging into his voice and God's voice throughout all of Scripture, seeing the way that Jesus unifies the story of human history. And that thirdly, that you would really not just experience that, but that you would listen. Listening is really really about taking what you're hearing, and absorbing it. The actual Hebrew word for listen is such a beautiful one. It's Shema. It's Shema, which actually really means to hear and then to obey, right? So it's not just about hearing. It's about listening. It's about taking what you're hearing and allowing it to have a transformative effect on your life. And by the way, one of the things that I love about this scripture and how it lines up with what we're experiencing right now is next week I get to go on a men's retreat at Highlands Church. And it's going to be such a great experience. And I look forward to it because I know that men's retreat, and then there's another one at the end of the month, a women's retreat. And why do we do this? Because we know that people who spend time away and they spend time away with Jesus and they reflect on Jesus and the way that he brings the story of human history together and that we're a part of it, and the way that we listen to them, that changes people. There's actually transformation that takes place in the world, in our life. And a lot of times people say, hey, you know what? I wish I could experience that every day. I wish I could experience that every week. And every retreat I've ever been to, the answer is you can. You can. You don't have to wait till the next retreat. This is something you can experience day in and day out. This is something you can make a part of your practice so that you can actually be a take heart kind of person where you are becoming so aware of the constant presence and power of Jesus Christ that you have taken heart so much that you never get truly discouraged. Because no matter how hard the troubles are in this world, that you are aware that Jesus is over all of that. So again, listen to the voice of Jesus, because when you take it to heart with action, change happens, seismic change. In fact, Peter was so obedient to Jesus that the whole entire Roman Empire got turned upside down within just a number of years. The greatest power on the face of the planet got changed because of the faithful obedience of Peter and those people who he was able to communicate Jesus' gospel to. This is the last little bit of our story today. It says, as they were coming down the mountain, Jesus ordered them not to tell anyone what they had seen until after the human one, he's referring to himself, had risen from the dead. Now, then it goes on to say, so they kept it to themselves. They were obedient, wondering, what's this rising from the dead thing? I love that. What is this whole rising? They didn't really comprehend. They didn't understand what Jesus was saying to them. In fact, that's true throughout all of Jesus's ministry. And even when Jesus did get crucified, they still didn't understand until he actually rose from the dead. But notice they actually, Jesus says, I want you to keep it to yourselves until the human one has risen from the dead. And so yes, he says, keep it a secret, but it's actually a command that turns into a different command once he's risen from the dead. See, it's no longer a secret. Instead, he says, now, The obvious outcome of this is that once he's risen from the dead, you should not keep it to yourself. You should share it with everybody. And so the fourth thing that we need to know in order to escape from the constant confinement or imprisonment or enslavement in our life that's sucking the color out, the fourth thing is this: share what you learn about Jesus. Share it. Make sure that you are communicating what you know and what you've experienced with Jesus in that special time away with him, where you've spent time listening to his voice and you've spent time reflecting on how Jesus unifies the story of human history and the way that he dialogues in scripture. And that it's not just a dead gospel, it's not old words, but it's actually living, it's actually written by people who are alive right now with Jesus and who are even right now talking about the church and praying for the church. It's such a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful vision of what we've been welcomed into that dialogue. And so one of the things that is always a challenge at this time of year or any time of year as we're leading up to Easter is to ask ourselves, who is God asking us to share the story of his good news with? And my simple way of doing it this time of year is I grab one of the yard signs, which we're handing out today, and I put those in my yard. And I know that for people that I've been casually kind to and have just sought to be a good neighbor to over the year, my prayer is that they would feel comfortable and they would feel encouraged and even curious to come and experience what life is like. See, the whole year is the witness. Now is just the time when I'm able to say, hey, you know what? You know all that witness? This is really what matters. I don't ever put any yard signs in my yard. Nothing. I make sure no yard signs go in my yard except for the ones that tell people about Jesus, because I really want to make sure that I take all of that relational capital I've built up in life and in those connections that I have, and I pour it in one direction and into one focus. And so for me, that's the way I do it. Other people have different ways of communicating. But the real question is, how are you sharing that truth? Because Jesus did give us a command. And God the Father spoke over his son, Jesus, and said, you must listen to him. Because this is God himself. This is no different than God speaking. This is Jesus' commands. It is God. And Jesus said, keep it secret until the rising. Which means we should not keep it secret now. Which means that everybody should know. And that we have a command. We have from his very voice that encouragement in our life to be bold. And in fact, when we do that, we are actually given the best opportunity to have a front row seat. I have some friends who have had front row seats at basketball games, and they've had front row seats at football games, and they've come away and they've said, man, that was such a great experience. I remember when I was a kid, we used to go into the basketball arena and we'd get the nosebleed seats, and we kind of hoped that it was a bad game, because if it was a bad game, then the people in the lower area of the stadium would start to leave their seats. And so obviously middle schoolers, we thought that me and my friend thought we were so clever to sneak down to the seats at the court side, thinking that no one noticed, but we knew the ushers were letting us do it, the people in charge, but we'd sneak down there. And I remember one time when we got right up there court side and realized how big the players were and how vibrant and alive the game was. And I remember feeling so special for having a front row seat. When you share the gospel of Jesus with other people, you are accepting God's extension of a ticket to the front row seat of God's work in the world. You are actually saying, you know, I'd really like to not just hear about Jesus's constant presence and power or even experience it in my life, which is so powerful, but I would like to see what happens when I employ it, when I share it with other people. And that can be so creative in so many ways to do it. So I pray that right now you're starting to think about creative ways you do it, because everybody's different. Not everybody's gonna be a yard sign kind of person, and not everybody's gonna be the kind of person that's gonna host a party or even gonna feel comfortable emailing someone or making a phone call or sending a text message. Not everybody's gonna have a different way, but I know that the command stays the same for all of us. Jesus said, keep it a secret until the Son of Man, until the human one has risen, which means now Jesus is risen. It's no longer a secret, and our command is to share it so that everybody would know. I pray that this conversation, this take heart conversation, has been helpful for you as we've reflected on what it means to take those retreat experiences, those experiences that a lot of people think, you know, I can only have on a retreat, and to take those into our daily life so that we become the kind of people that are no longer sucked away by the constant activity of life, that we're no longer slaves to this need, even a need for constant activity, but instead we find peace. And that's what Jesus was doing with his disciples, pulling them up away from the constant activity of ministry, the constant demands, and into a special space with him. And Jesus wants the same for each one of us as we journey through life. So make sure you listen for Jesus's invitation to follow him up the mountain, to engage in scripture, to listen to his voice, and then to share the truth that you know about Jesus. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you so much for who you are. We thank you that we have a way out of the enslavement of constant activity or the need to have constant activity in our life. that we actually recognize in those special moments with you, we get filled up and we get renewed and we get drawn into a place of vibrancy with our, with your past, which you have done in our past, and what you're going to do in our future. And so, God, in this moment, I pray that we all pray that you would speak to us powerfully in our spaces, our living rooms, through our phones and our televisions and our computers. Lord God, may we each of us who hear this message soak it into our souls that you are a good God and you're meeting us right here, right now, and you are saying, please come away with me. And so we praise you, God, for what you're doing. We praise you, God. And we pray this in Jesus' holy name. And all God's people said together, amen.
Keep on getting better. Keep on.